Hey, what's up? I'm Deniz Koyu. Welcome to my home studio in Essen in Germany. When we started designing this studio, the first thing that was really important is the acoustics in here. Then the main layout, what the speakers and stuff like the TV screen, the desk, just the main layout here of the studio, which is really simple actually. It's just all about the sound. I've been to so many studios and I was rarely happy with the sound. So I'm very picky about that. So, but I know that Misha builds these studios that sound really amazing and they are very linear in the frequency response. So that's really important, I think. And that was the main thing for me because I found this place here. It's actually my apartment and I wanted to have that combined. This was my dream, to have the studio, a studio like this inside my apartment, because my bedroom is right next to the studio. And this is amazing. I wake up in the morning and then I just have to walk through the corridor and I'm in the studio. So I knew the size of the room here. And then we were like, okay, what can we build inside this room? And the clever system about the studio is, this is actually kind of like a cage, maybe you can say, floating almost. Yeah, this is the basic system here is, it's a wooden frame and you got all these panels in here and then the ceiling is on top. So that's the system of the studio. But the cool thing is we could take this out and put it in a different room. We could even adjust the size. We could just take out frames here of panels and then adjust the size, make it wider or smaller, whatever, and then put it in a different room. So it's mobile almost. Of course, it would take a week maybe to, you know, set everything up again, but it is mobile, so that's a cool thing. At the beginning, when we designed the studio, I didn't decide to switch to analog yet. I didn't have the mixing desk yet. There was we finished the studio in December last year, and in the same month, I was in Vegas in a studio, and I worked with that mixing engineer guy who is in the Wind Studios, and he showed me that SSL matrix, and I tried it out, and I was so impressed by that sound, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna get it. And then we adjusted the desk and made it integrated into the desk, and yeah, I got some outboard gear in those pillows left and right, which is really cool. Everything is hooked up to the SSL matrix, and then everything goes back into my Apogee Symphony and yeah, back into my MacBook. The cool thing also is the MacBook Pro is my center station actually. So I take my MacBook on the road, I produce on the road, on tour all the time, and then when I come back home, come into the studio, I take my MacBook, put it on the desk, and I need two Thunderbolt cables. Everything is going into a Thunderbolt hub, and then this hub is connected to the screen, to the TV, to the Symphony, to the Virus, and to the mixing desk, because the mixing desk requires USB and Ethernet. So everything is going into the Thunderbolt hub and then going into my MacBook. It's really, really cool, and it actually works flawless. It's a remix that I'm working on for Röyksopp featuring Robyn. Actually, the remix isn't finished yet. I'm still working on it, but I think it's a pretty cool project to show all the sounds that I did, the arrangement, the mixing also, everything that is involved. I will explain everything, and maybe later on we can actually continue working on the arrangement, because that's the part that I'm working on. I've done the intro, the first drop, the breakdown, and then I'm working on the second build-up and the second drop. So maybe then we can go through that and I'll show you how I continue to work on the project. To be honest, most of it is actually done from scratch, but I'll show you what I've used. Of course, I used the vocal. So it's the amazing voice of Robyn. This is it. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. I have only used the chorus, actually. There's more to it, verses and stuff, but I used only the chorus. So that's the vocal, and then I used a couple of the pads and strings of the original. So there's this one. It's like a starter pad kind of thing. Then there's these strings. I love them. They create a lot of atmosphere and a great vibe. It builds up later on to this. Actually, these strings, I think in the original track, they are used for a bridge part only, but I like them so much that I took them and I'm using them as the main riff for my breakdown. And then there is something else. Oh yeah, then there are these step chords in the original. This is this one here. And again. What I did is I replayed those steps and I created more layers to it, but I will show that later on. That's all. All that I think. Yeah, that's all I used from the original. I took a couple of samples from these parts and then I created effect sounds and stuff. I'll show you one example, but I will explain how I made it actually. Like this one. Like an arpeggiator, but it comes from a sample from the original. I will explain how I made it. And this one. It's like an arpeggiator, but coming from the original stuff, so I'll explain it. But that's all. The rest is all from scratch and a couple of stuff that I replayed. I will get to that later on when we come to the breakdown part, but from the beginning on, the intro and the first drop is everything done from scratch. So it actually could be an original track, a single track.
Cool, let's hear it.
Okay, so let's start with the intro. I'll play it to you first. The intro. You have this one little glitch right before the drop because the CPU of my MacBook Pro is kind of at its limit. But yeah, we'll just ignore that for now. So okay, all the stuff that's happening in the intro, I will explain all the separate tracks. Actually, it's like very few tracks only, but there's a lot of effect sounds in it and a lot of processing and stuff that's going on and a lot of automation to make it really interesting. Okay, so basically, let's start from the beginning, the kick drum in here. For the kick drum, I've been using the new Nicky Romero plugin. I don't know if you know it, it's an amazing plugin. If you don't know it, then really look into it. You can create your own kick drums with it. You can pretty much tweak and tune everything with it. It's so amazing because you can tune your kick drums. In this case, first of all, I always make sure I want to check what is the key of my track actually. In this case, it's actually F. It's the key of the original track, but the track is built around a chord that is F and A sharp. So I was able to decide, okay, do I want to make the track on F or on A sharp? And I picked A sharp just because the bass line sounds, it sounds better on A sharp. So the key for the track now is A sharp. And now what I've done here in the Nicky Romero plugin is this kick drum is tuned on A sharp, but this is only for the intro. Because A sharp is pretty high for a kick drum. You don't have the really deep sub in it. If you play it solo, this is it. It's pretty high. But for the intro, it's cool because I don't want to have these really powerful subs in it yet. So I tuned it on A sharp, and then later in the drop, there's actually a switch. It's a different kick drum, and then this kick drum in the drop goes to F, because it's built on F and A sharp. So my real bass drum is on F. So this is the kick drum, and I actually used two plugins for this. One is the Cubase tube plugin. This is some kind of distortion, because I wanted to make sure that you can really hear the tone of the kick drum, to make that really, you know, very, very tonal. Without this, it's like that. When I turn it on, you get just a little bit more of that distortion. I can turn it up, actually, then it sounds like this. But I don't want it to be a hardstyle kick drum, so I made it pretty low. And then another effect on this kick drum is a certain kind of room reverb that I have. It's a special setting. I think this one is, it's the Lexicon room reverb, Lexicon. It's a very, very short reverb, and it creates a certain effect that's more like a delay, actually. So if you listen close, there is a certain, can you say slapback? Yeah, if I turn it off, it's just a pure kick drum, but this little slapback, it creates a certain groove in it. And I want to have these kinds of, I always work with that kind of sounds to make special stuff that is, you cannot really recognize it in the full mix, but if you turn it off, then there's something missing. And these little sounds, they just fill up the whole mix, and they create groove. So this would be kind of boring, and if I turn it on, it starts to move in your neck, kind of. Okay, so that's a kick drum. Then I have this snare drum and a little tom. I actually sampled those ones. I think it's from Fake Blood. And you can hear the slapback of the kick drum. It really fits with the snare drum. It's almost like an off hi-hat, kind of. And I just automated this, and I'm building up the gain on the snare drum just so you get into that groove. I want it to be really smooth and, you know, like slowly building it up and getting into that kind of groove. Okay, that's it. And then a very simple closed hi-hat. This is really not special. Just again, I'm building it up with the gain. There's just a hall reverb on it, and one simple EQ. I'm just cutting out all the low frequencies. I do that all the time. When I got cymbals, hi-hats, I usually cut them at like 400 hertz, sometimes even higher. It depends on the sample, but usually I don't want any mid or low frequencies in it. That's it. And now the magic happens in these four tracks here. That's actually the introduction to the bass line. So I'll play it to you in solo. This is the main sound here. It's very simple, it's an arpeggiator. This is a silent, and what I did here, I took a preset at first, and then I tweaked it a lot and changed the sound and adjusted it to something that I wanted it to be. This is actually how I what I do most of the time is I browse through presets and I find something that might inspire me. And then from there, I take it and then I tweak it so much. And in the end, it turns into something totally different, but you have to find some point where you get inspired. And presets is a great way to do that. So in that case, this is a silent sound and it has four oscillators. It's mixed up. It's like a square saw, actually three saws, one square, and a lot of voices, a lot of detune. So that makes that sound really fat. And then there is the arpeggiator, the internal arpeggiator of the silent is turned on. And there is a certain melody in it. Like I programmed it inside the arpeggiator. So it's like two semitones down and then five semitones down. That makes the kind of the movement like a melody. So I was looking into that arpeggiator for a long time just to tweak the groove of it, to set the groove of the arpeggiator. I tried so many different versions of this. It took me a long time. And then I had like, I don't know, 15 different grooves. And in the end, I decided for this one. Processing wise, there's an EQ. I'm just cutting the low frequencies, a bit of the high frequencies, just to make sure that everything on top of above like 18 kilohertz, 17 kilohertz is cut. And then what I often do is I pull up the Q of the EQ, here this one, to make sure I get a bit of the resonance here at the cutting frequency, because this is actually how EQs are supposed to be. Usually like when you have the analog EQs, this is always happening. You always have that kind of resonance at the cutting frequency and it just makes the sound a little bit more natural. So I try to incorporate that when I use my plugin EQs. That's the first one. And now I'm routing it to a group channel. And now here's a lot of stuff happening actually. First one is another EQ. Again, I'm cutting low frequencies and high frequencies only because there are four channels going into that group and I'm just making sure once again that there's no low frequencies in it. And now here I have a little dip. This is like 500 hertz. It's just, this is, you know, it's for the tone actually. So you have to play around with it and see what happens when you take out some frequencies, when you raise some frequencies. I'll do that all the time. I just want to shape the sound the way I want to do. In that case, I want this arpeggiator to sound very sawy, kind of. And what I do then is I usually increase around 1.5 to 2 kilohertz. I always increase a little bit and then you get this really, it sounds a bit more aggressive when you do that to saws. And again, this shape that I'm doing here in the EQ, once again, it's kind of, that's the natural way how an EQ is supposed to be. So when you dip it here, you should have another little hill next to it. So with analog EQs, you always have these moves. It's not possible to have just one dip at a certain frequency like you can do it with plugin EQs. It's okay, you can do it. But if you want to have a natural sound, try to make these waves. It's more natural and it sounds better. Of course, only in case if you want to do like a surgical EQ and you want to cut out like one very specific frequency, then you do it with a very sharp EQ, very sharp Q, and you just cut it out and that's it. But in that case, I want to shape the sound. This is not a surgical EQ. It's like I want to shape the sound. So I'm doing it with those waves. Okay, that's the EQ. Next plugin is the Brainworks BX Saturator. This is it's a saturator. It distorts a little bit and it has the mid-side kind of thing going on. And what I did here is I took the side low and I increased it here, the gain on the side low by 5 dB. And that in that way, I actually widen the sound because I'm taking the sides, the low part, and I increase it here, so that makes the whole sound more wide. Next plugin is the Camel Crusher. One of my favorite distortion plugins. This is so good. It has this this distortion section here, a filter compressor. Just try it out. It's amazing. I always use this Mac knob here and a bit of the tube. If I turn it off, on. It's a big difference. It makes it so much more edgy and aggressive, so I love it. Next one is the sausage fattener. You have to be very careful with this plugin. It's amazing, but it adds so much stuff, so I usually pull it up to like something between 5 to 10%, not more, and it already changes a lot. So it's great. It's a great distortion plugin, but be careful with the fatness. If I turn it off, on. Yeah, it's a little bit fatter than before, but yeah. Then this EQ here. Once again, I'm doing that kind of wave thing here. I'm cutting off some of the high frequencies. I'm doing that after the crusher and the fattener because they change the frequencies again. You got to be careful when you use those distortion plugins. You will always add low frequencies, actually. So you always got to check again. I mean, I EQ'd it twice before, but after those plugins, I will get low frequencies again. And this is only mutt. I don't want that to be in, so I'm cutting it here again. I'm increasing once again around that frequency, those 2 kilohertz. And here I'm doing that shape thing again, that wave shape. And final plugin is my favorite beloved volume shaper. I love this one. I use it for the sidechain all the time. It's my favorite plugin to create the sidechain effect. It's amazing because you can create any kind of shape with it. I actually use it for different things as well. I'm going to show you later. I'm using it sometimes for different rhythms also, but it's my favorite plugin to create the sidechain effect. You can really be very precise and be very careful and shape it to the exact movement that you want it to be. That's it. Then else I always use this FreeG plugin from Sonaxis for my gaining automation. I don't want to use the actual Cubase fader for automation because if I do that, then I can't do the mixing later on anymore because then the fader will move and I don't want it to move with the automation. So I automate this fader and the Cubase fader is only for mixing. That's about it actually. And the final plugin here is the L2. I just use it at the very end. Actually, I do that all the time on my bus channels. In the end, I put an L2 because I don't want in case it clips, I don't want those. I don't want this to hit my limiter, because in that case, the limiter just gets too much of the energy. I can rather cut it here, and then I have more space for the limiter for all the other channels. So I can recommend that to you guys. Okay. So that's the processing. Once again, this is a bus channel and now I got 3 more layers and all of them are going through the whole chain of effects. Yeah. So what I did now is I duplicated that layer and this one is exactly the same sound. All I did is I moved it up by 7 semitones. Yeah, 7 semitones. So I'm actually playing a chord almost. That's the first one, and the second, that's what happens. It's the same sound, just 7 semitones up. And it's also the same automation going on. So the filter is opening up, I got a gain automation, the gain is moving up, and then I'm automating the gate of the arpeggiator inside the silence. Just to make at the beginning it's very short, and then it's opening up, so it gets a bit like almost like you increase the release kind of. That's the second layer, and now it gets really interesting. This is the layer number 3. This is now where all the effects come in, because those 2 layers that I explained now, they are pretty static. I have those cutoff automation and arpeggiator gate automation in it, but besides that, it's very static, but I want to make sure now it's just a short loop. So you got to be a bit more creative with it and make sure that there's movement happening, that there are some effects going on. So I will play to you first solo. There's constantly happening something, but rhythmically. So as you can hear, it's kind of a bit crusher effect that changes all the time. And then there's delays and reverbs, and it sounds very complicated maybe. And you would think maybe it's so much automation going on and must be so hard to make this, but it's in fact, it's really simple. It's this new plugin that I got for Reactor. It's called Molecular. And honestly, for me, this is the most amazing plugin I've tried in maybe, I don't know, the last 2-3 years. This is the most amazing thing ever. It's an effect unit. You have 4 slots in this thing. You can put 4 different effects. So in this case, it's a vocoder, it's a delay, a chorus, and this lo-fi thing, that's the kind of a bit crusher effect. And then there's LFOs, 4 LFOs. And these LFOs, they create steps in those effects, so they change the effect all the time, and you can program it in any way you want it to be, and you can route those effects, and you have control on the whole thing. You can control the mix of every single effect. You can automate all volumes, all knobs if you want to, like the position factor here in the lo-fi, the pitch of the vocoder effect, everything you can control. But the thing is, it's like an automation machine, this thing, because of all the LFOs and everything that this thing is doing by itself. So I programmed it this way that it's stepping through the bit crusher levels, and the delays and reverbs are happening in this one too. You got this sweet display here, and it shows you how it switches through the different steps. I recommend to read the manual of this thing. It's kind of, it's complex, but on the other hand, you got all the presets in this thing, and they are so inspiring. It's really amazing. Just put them on some of your sounds and see what happens, and you'll be amazed. Okay, that's the one. There's actually, again, a lot of different processing on this. I got one more sausage fattener, because in this case, this is the sound that creates a bit of the deep frequencies for the intro. It's you got those, you can actually hear it. It's like in the penguin, you can see it's that 80 hertz kind of thing, 80 to 100, this that peak. And it fits very well with my kick drum. The kick drum, as I explained, is not that deep either, so it goes together very well and creates certain cool moods. So the sausage fattener just lifts up those frequencies a bit. Just another EQ. Kind of, once again, my crazy wave shapes in there. One special plugin, another really nice one, is the Vengeance Stereo Bundle. It's a really complex plugin. I think it's the most complex plugin for stereo modification. You got so much stuff in it. You have you have a mono bus and a stereo bus, and you can treat them separately with compressor, EQ, and an expander, and it's crazy routing in there. Honestly, what I usually do, I just browse through the presets, because there are so many presets in it, and you will find something that's cool, and then you can modify it and tweak it, make it a bit wider or less, or maybe tweak the EQ a bit. So that usually always works. And in this case, it actually does a lot to the sound. When I turn it off, it really falls down. When I enable it, especially those sub frequencies, they get wide. Usually, I want to make sure that the sub frequencies are always mono, But when I have an intro, also a breakdown part, I like it a lot when the bass is actually white, because it creates a certain, it's more atmospheric. You don't want it to be very, it doesn't have to be that punchy. It needs to be mono, because that's the most punchy way you can get it in your face. But in this case, for the intro and for the break, that's not necessary. I just want to create an atmosphere so the bass can actually be white. And yeah, this is a great plugin to do that. Once more, the volume shaper for my sidechain. And that's it. And then I duplicated it a fourth time, and I put another molecular on it with a different setting, completely different. This one is more like a phaser effect. So in solo, this is what it sounds like. You have this constant movement in it, so that makes it really interesting. Else, this intro would be really boring, because it's just a short loop and there's nothing else happening, but with all these sounds, it's moving, and that's what makes it come alive. These really wide stereo delays in it. That's the dual delay here and the dub delay. Both kind of work together. And then there's this filter here that creates the phaser effect. And yeah, it's like a circle movement in here with the LFOs. So as I said, you gotta read the manual to really understand this thing, but it's worth it. Yeah, so these are the main sounds for the intro. And then I did one little trick here. It's an automation with the large reverb that I have. So I created a scent effect, and that is, the Valhalla Room. It's a very large setting with a large decay, and then I'm automating it here. As you can see, this is the automation. It goes together with the groove of the bass line, because it hits on the long note of the bass line. Ba-da-da, bam, ba-dum, ba-da-da, bam, ba-dum. Okay, I gotta explain this as well. What's happening here is in the MIDI of the bass line, I'm just moving up the pitch. I'm doing a pitch bend. This is it. Moving it slowly up. I'm doing that on all the four channels, and now with the reverb, what happens is that the reverb is going up in steps, because I'm hitting it only on those certain points, and then it's moving up and up and up. It's constantly rising. Yeah, that's almost it. There's like one more little thing. It's a sample that I took from the original, and it's this little chord here. I took it from this pad that I showed you earlier, this one. So I just took the first section. I did it, first of all, because when I'm making a remix, I want to make sure that I have certain elements of the original already coming up in the intro, just to, you know, to get the vibe of the original in it. Plus, also, it adds some harmonies to the bass line. Because if you have the bass line itself, you got this. And now, so kind of reminds me of some of the old house records from like 5 years ago. They used to use those chords. yeah, I still got that in me, so I like that. Yeah, that's the intro, I think. Oh yeah, one little trick I'm gonna tell you also is I'm doing an automation with the gain on my master channel here, because in the very beginning of the intro, the sounds are not that loud yet, but I wanna make sure that especially as a DJ, when you start hitting the play button and you start to play the track from the beginning, you want to have a full gain, actually. Just if you have a lot of dynamics in it, then the DJ might end up in increasing the gain. I don't want that. I want to make sure that the peaks in the intro already hit the 0 dB. So what I do is I automate the 3G on my master channel, and I just increase the gain. And then I slowly start to decrease with the more sounds that come in, that increases the gain on my master channel. So then I decrease the 3G. I start with 2.5 decibels in this case, but it can be different in other tracks. And then I go down to, actually, I'm going down to something below 0 dB. Yeah, I'm going down to -1.5, and then right before the drop, I pull it up to 0 to make sure that you get more energy. It's very important that when the drop comes in, you know, you really feel it, like you need more gain. So I always do that. I do the same thing in the breakdown. I go down with the gain, and then right before the drop comes in, I pull it up again so there's more energy to it. It works very well in the clubs. I do that before the limiter because I want the dynamics to increase. If I do that with the limiter, then you hit the limiter, and then it's like a brick wall limiter that you basically lower the wall. That's what happens. But I don't want that to happen. I want the dynamics to increase, to you know, to have more air in it. And then when the drop comes in, I want it to hit the wall again. So, yeah. One last thing I wanted to show in the intro is this little snare build-up that I've done here. I'm gonna play it to you solo. It's very simple, actually, but... it comes right before the drop. What I did is I just used the contact. I do that all the time for those kinds of effects because it does the pitching for snare drums very well, so you can use it for that. So I'm just using put in my snare drum in the contact, and then I'm doing it with MIDI, basically. This is the pitching, and I'm increasing the reverb that's happening when it builds up. So it's just an automation with the hall reverb here. And that's it. I'm moving into the break part, but this section here, that's the main drop. So yeah, let's look into it. First thing is what I mentioned before. I have a different kick drum here for the drop. It's once again, it's the Nicky Romero plugin, but it's a different setting, and the pitch here goes from G sharp to F. So I have that kind of movement. It ends up on F. So because as I explained, the track is built around a chord that's F and A sharp, so it works really well. And for the kick drum, F is a really great note. I usually try to use F or G, so that works great. Everything else, it's kind of difficult because anything above G is actually too high for kick drums, and anything below F is too low. So try to move somewhere between F and G. And if it doesn't fit with the key of your track, then what you can do is just make the envelope of the pitch, the range, make it higher. So you could go from, let's say, A to F. So it's a high, the movement is it's a wide range, so that means that you don't end up on a certain tone. It just moves. It's a pitch envelope, so it doesn't sit on a certain note. Okay, so. This is the, it moves from the F kick to the very tonal A sharp distorted kick drum with a little room reverb on it. Okay, that's a kick drum. Then, yeah, just this little off hi-hat that I've also been using in the intro, it's in here too. I think I automated it. Yeah, it's a gain automation here just to build it up slowly. And now here comes the actual sub bass, which I didn't use before. What I did is, I think it's very simple. I just duplicated my main bassline arpeggiator, the silent. And as I explained before, my main bass sound has four oscillators. It's three saws, one square, a lot of different voices, lots of detunes. So for the sub bass here, I stripped it all down. I stripped it down to only one saw, one voice, no detune, it's full mono, that's it, because I don't want it to be wide and all those effects, but I want the same arpeggiator movement in it, so it sounds like this. This is very much of a 303 kind of feeling to it. I'll explain the processing on it, but first, this is on A sharp 2, and this is kind of high for a really powerful deep sub bass, but I need those frequencies because I have to kind of connect my main bass sound to the real deep sub bass. There has to be something in between because I duplicated it a second time, and the other one is on A1, A sharp 1. So it's one octave lower, and this sounds like that. There's a very deep sidechain to it because I want to make sure it doesn't interfere with my kick drum. But so you have this very low A sharp 1 sub bass, then I duplicated it for the A sharp 2, and that A sharp 2 thing connects everything, it melts it together, it connects my main bass sound to the sub. These are the two together, and with my main bass line sound, it's like. And then with the kick drum, so this is the fundament for the whole drop. Yeah, regarding the processing, it's just a couple of EQs. For the bass, for subs, I like to use the Oxford EQ because it's really, really precise. I think the only thing I did here is I increased one of the harmonics on the sub bass. I'm gonna tell you a little trick. I'm gonna show you something. This one is a frequency chart. It's from a guy called Tischmeier. I think he's from Steinberg, I think. And I use it all the time to look up the exact frequencies of specific notes. So in this case, the bass line is going on A sharp. So I'm hitting 58 hertz and 117. So let's say I want to increase the first harmonic. I would take an EQ, go exactly to 117 hertz, and then do certain gaining. So and I watch it on my Penguin to see what's really going on. So that's, I can really recommend that if you want to work precisely, take a chart like that. I think you can grab this one from the internet. Just Google frequency chart Tischmeier, you'll find it. Oh yeah, here I have a very, very hard 48 dB octave cut, low cut, just to make sure that the very, very low frequencies in this sound are not going through, because it's basically only mutt. You want to have more headroom, so cut it. Then I make sure the sound is 100% mono. So I'm taking this is the stereo enhancer from Cubase, and I just enable the mono thing. You can use any kind of plugin, but make sure that your sub for the drop is really mono. That's it. Then there's only the very hard sidechain. These are two different sidechains. So the very low sub bass has this really hard sidechain, and the higher one doesn't need to be that hard because it's not going to interfere with the kick drum that much. So as you can see, this is the curve for the second sub bass, and it's much more relaxed. And I actually used one waves effect on the second sub bass. That's the Kramer kind of thing. It's a little bit of distortion to it. This is enabled, and when I turn it off, when I turn it on, it adds some of those harmonics again. I want it to be a bit more edgy. And the rest of it is actually, it's the same thing that's going on in the intro, just automation again. So right before the drop, I'm pulling down the cutoff just to make sure I want to, you know, when I come from the build-up and I go into the drop, I want to make sure it really falls down into that deep sound and you get the sub bass and it sounds like really powerful. So I do that with the automation. I think I'm doing that. Yeah, I'm doing that to all of the layers. This is the cutoff. It just goes down and then whoop. And then I start to increase it. I build it up from the beginning of the drop till the beginning of the break. So I make sure that I have constant moving again. This is one of the things you have to be, you really got to take care of when you make progressive house, because I think progressive house is really based on loops, and it can get very repetitive. So you got to make sure you have some movements in it, stuff going on. So you do it with automation. Yeah, the rest is just the same layers. The molecular kind of stuff. I think a couple of times I made sure that those really crazy effects of the molecular are not that obvious in the drop part. It's cool to have it in the intro, but in the drop part it might be a bit too confusing. So in some of those, because as I told you, you can control all of the knobs of this thing. So especially what I do is I control the mute and the mix of the separate effects. So sometimes I just turn it down in case it gets too crazy and then pull it up again. So I just listen to the whole thing, and then I think I actually recorded it with the desk here. You can control the thing here, and then I recorded it, and when it gets too much, I just pull it down and then pull it up again. Yeah, I got this one little sound here that's a siren. Starts to build up here, I think. Yeah. Just starts increasing. I took a massive, it's a really simple sound actually. I made it from scratch, but it's really simple. It's just one oscillator, saw wave, and the filter, and this movement is happening with one of those LFOs here, I think. It's number 5, yeah. I just synced it, ratio 1:4, and that's the curve, is I think one of the sine things. I made this a while ago, so. Yeah, this is the LFO is linked to the pitch of the oscillator here. And then it just creates that movement, and the rest is done by the pitch envelope here in the MIDI. Very simple, but effective. Yeah, so that's the drop. I got this one right sound too.
What's the little vocoder?
Yeah, that's just what, yeah. I want to show that too. It's that kind of complex draw, kind of vocoder effect. So what I did is I took a massive once again, and I think this is a preset actually. I took it from a preset library, and then I just tweaked it a bit. There's a lot of processing on it once again. To be honest, those kinds of sounds, you can look it up on YouTube. You can find so many tutorials on how to create those sounds. It's really simple, actually. It's like there are so many presets for it. And what you have to do is it all happens in the automation. So in that case, you have those macro controls in the massive. And in this presets, you have this one macro control called talk. So you just have to automate the talk thing and then it starts talking. It's really simple. But there's, as I said, there's a lot of processing on it. Once again, just an EQ. Here again, I increase on the 2 kHz thing to get it more edgy. And a cutoff, once again with my waves in it. Oh, this is one of my favorite plugins as well, the Saturn. It's a distortion plugin. It can create really crazy effects, lots of modulation and stuff. In that case, I think it's just a bit of saturation. When I turn it off, very subtle, but it adds a bit of distortion to it. Then I have AutoPan. This is a Cubase plugin. Just so, because I used that a couple of times on different sounds. It's very nice to have auto pan effects, especially because these kids these days they listen so much on earphones, on their iPhones and iPods. And then when you create those kinds of effects, it makes it a lot more interesting. Yeah, then I used twice the Decepitator of it's the Sound Toys plugins. Also, this bundle is one of my favorite plugins, the Sound Toys stuff. Check it out. They have the Decepitator. They have a very great delay plugin, the Echo Boy. They have a phaser kind of plugin, the Phase Mistress is called. It's amazing stuff. So high quality. It's a bit expensive, but it's really worth it. And in this case, I used it twice. I'm going to turn it off now. This is without it. First one, second, so the first one adds a bit of the low frequencies, makes it a bit distorted in the low mids, and the second one adds a bit of noise to it, so it sounds a bit more robotic, kind of. That's it. And there's one more EQ, I think, yeah, probably. I'm just cutting the low frequencies and then doing once again my favorite wave shape to increase the low mids. That's it. And then my room reverb. By the way, another tip, make sure that you don't create too many different reverbs. What I always do is I create, like, for the whole project, in this case, I have 3 different reverbs. A room reverb, a hall, and a large hall, and that's it. And then use only those ones and just play around with the amount of send. So you can increase it, or you have to choose the right type of room. But if you create too many different reverbs, it just sounds messed up and it's not natural sounding. I always try to think of what would it be like if I record a band, if it's something natural. In this case, you're recording in an actual room and you can't create 15 different types of rooms, so try to keep that in mind. Yeah, so in this case, on that vocoder sound, I've just used my room reverb. That's the same reverb that I used on the kick drum in the intro. When I turn it off, when I turn it on, it's kind of a delay, actually. It's really cool for those sounds. And now it gets really interesting in the break part, actually. I'm gonna play it to you once more from the point when it starts to transit into the break part. I try to make it really smooth. I mean, this is a question of arrangement, but what I really don't like these days is you have so many tracks that do the same thing in the breakdown. What happens is it drops down into zero, into nothing. So you got this one big boom effect, boom, and then the whole track falls down into nothing, zero. And then there's a melody coming up, some cheesy chords or whatever. But the thing is, when you want to play a good DJ set and you have like 3 of those tracks behind each other, then this happens all the time. Like every 2 minutes, you drop down into zero. And then it just doesn't work that way. And I know that all my DJ friends and everybody is doing edits and mashups, always cutting that and trying to make it more coherent and trying to skip those drops. So why actually do it? So I try to make sure in my arrangements I avoid that and I make it more smooth. So I'll play it to you. Everything that's happening behind this boom effect here is still under construction. So now is the second build-up is coming up, but that's still what I'm working on. But yeah, you heard all the sounds in the break part. And yeah, I'll show you what's happening here. A lot of layers, actually. So let's start from the top. I showed you the parts before that I'm using from the original. One of the main parts is this. Those strings here. And what I'm doing is I'm mixing that with my bass line because it goes together really well, kind of like this. Because what happens is before the bass line has been very monotone, it's all just on around A sharp. But now with the chords, all of a sudden, there are harmonies coming up while the bass line just continues. So it's a really cool way for working out the arrangement and also for avoiding that gap that all the other guys are doing. So it makes it really rich at that moment. And it's like all of a sudden, it opens up. So coming from here. And I'm just filtering down the bass line, increasing the reverb, so it fades out with the reverb. But there are a lot more layers, actually. What I'm doing here, I'm cutting out the sub bass. Sub bass is not running anymore. Instead, I got a different bass for the break part. That's a guitar kind of bass. Solo. It's I think it's an Omnisphere. Yeah. I love this plugin. The Omnisphere is amazing for any kind of melodic sounds. It's yeah, one of my favorite plugins. In this case, it's just a preset for the guitar, bass kind of thing. And I'm using the amp simulator. That's a Cubase plugin again. When I turn it off, it sounds like this. Turn it on. Off. On. So, sounds more distorted. I'm using some compression with the C4 multiband compression. I think I'm doing that because I want to make sure that the levels of the sub frequencies are more constant, that there's not that much dynamic in it, because it was a bit too much, I think. Yeah, I'm just compressing the sub frequencies. Probably another EQ. Yep, just cutting the high frequencies. That's it. So I'm switching from my main sub bass to that bass for the breakdown. Together with the strings, it sounds like this. Yeah, quite simple. Next thing is harmonies, chords. I replayed the chords from the original and it turned out like this. Yeah. What I'm doing here is I'm using a lot of the I'm playing around with the velocity in my MIDI to create that that switching kind of thing. It's a 1/18th rhythm, and here you can see that the first one is always a higher velocity than the second one, so you get that dum bum 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 kind of effect. Plus, then it's combined with a sidechain effect that is where is it? I think it's actually in that case the filter shaper. Yeah. When I turn it off. Yeah. On. This thing, it's another plugin, the filter shaper. You can do a sidechain with it too, but in that case, I'm doing it with a filter, not with gaining, but with filtering. So it sounds a bit different, and I liked it in that case. Yeah, this is that layer. There's a lot of stuff going on with different layers. This one is a piano, I think. I got three different pianos in here. My main piano is centered, and it sounds like this. I actually wanted to create kind of a Coldplay-ish vibe to it. That's what I had in mind. So in that case, I'm using the Alicia Keys piano from Native Instruments. Really, really nice one. It sounds so good. Again, with lots of processing on it. Just one API EQ. And this really cool plugin, the Vitalizer from Plugin Alliance. And I think what I'm doing here is I'm widening it a bit. I'm doing compression, and it has this processing knob in here and intensity, some stuff. I'm going to show you what happens when I turn it off. On. I'm not sure if you can hear it. You might have to sit in the middle actually to hear how it widens. I'm not sure if you can grab it on the camera, but If I push it more to extreme settings, off, on, it just gets a bit more wider and okay, so yeah, that's the main piano. This one is centered, and then I have two more piano layers. One is on the left, one is on the right, just to create, you know, atmosphere basically. This is the breakdown part, so you have to make it interesting, and I'm playing around with different sounds. So this one is panned to the right. It's very filtered, lots of low cut, lots of high cut, and it's a different piano. This one is the New York Grand from Native Instruments. It's just a different sound. I wanted to be, how can you explain those? I want it to be very centered in the mid frequencies, and you get that kind of piano sound. It sounds a bit like a damaged piano, but I like it. And I panned that one to the right. And then on the left, I have more like an effect piano. It's coming from the Omnisphere, and it's a reversed piano. Yeah, so you get that, it's more like a pad, and it's reversed. And that's on the left. And then on the right, you have the other piano. So there's a movement happening then from left to right, because it's like whoop, it moves up here and then you have the one on the right, so it sounds like this. So I get that constant movement in it. Else, if it was only the main center piano, I mean, it's a nice melody, but sound-wise, it wouldn't be that interesting. So, yeah. I like to do a lot of processing and playing around with that kind of stuff. That's the chords. And then there's this one sound from the original. I think, actually, I forgot to mention that sound in the beginning. I'm going to play it to you. Yeah, this was different than the original. I gotta show it to you. I'll show you the original sample. This one. Okay, so the original sounded like this. Super cheesy. It's one octave higher, and it was so cheesy, but I like the melody of it and the sound. So cheesy. So what I did is I cut a section out of it and I just pitched it down one octave, and I used the Cubase internal pitching. You go to effects and pitch shift it, and I did like one octave down, time correction, and then you can pick an algorithm for the time correction. There's different ones, you have to look into it. In that case, I would always use the poly, complex or musical. So after I pitched it, it sounds like that. I like that a lot better, more atmospheric kind of, and not that cheesy. I'm using one UAD compressor on this, the 1176, just to, basically, what I'm doing here is I'm increasing the reverb that's on the sample already to make it more dense. And then I replayed that melody with three different sounds. Again, this is Omnisphere, just replayed it. I didn't only replay it, I changed the melody a bit and I added a few more notes just the way I felt it was nice. Yeah, it's all on this sphere. This one and then this one. Just create some of those peaks. And another Omnisphere. I mean, all those kind of stuff is a matter of taste. You gotta pick your sounds and program them. And I think once you have a really nice melody, it's really easy to pick the right sounds, because if you have a really nice melody and great chords, then it will sound great with so many different sounds. You just have to choose the right one, and it's a matter of taste. When I play together, it sounds like this. And together with the piano, plus also those strings. Pretty simple, but yeah, this is all about the chords and the melodies, actually. And I did one little effect here. I sampled a little part of the vocal, and I pitched this with the Cubase pitching. So it actually happens, it plays the top notes of the chords. So what I what I'm doing is I'm getting in the voice of Robyn in here and melting it together with the chords. So it's like. So that again just creates some atmosphere. Final thing here in the breakdown is those step chords. I think I showed them to you earlier. Those guys here. This is from the original, and then I replayed them and added a few more layers. One is those strings. What I'm always doing is when I got chords, I create inversions of the chords to, you know, to just get different layers and to fill up certain frequencies again. Because as you can hear, this is while the other chords, they go like. This one was down, but the other one stays up. So it just, you know, it fills up certain space. And another layer here is this is once again the Omnisphere. I'm using it all the time for chords. It's the best. I think this one is Omnisphere again. It's all Omnisphere. I think this is pretty much it. The rest again is automation. There's a couple of drums going on. Oh, I'm going to show you this one too. The cymbals here. They are coming from Modern Drummer, I think. Yeah, Abbey Road Modern Drummer. It's a Native Instruments plugin. And the nice thing is these are actual recordings. So I use it because if you use samples, take like one sample, like one write sample, you have the same write all the time. But when you use a plugin like this, it's real recordings, and they recorded like, I don't know, 20 versions of the same write, and it plays a different version every time. So it sounds a lot more natural and alive. Yeah. Also here again, I'm doing a lot of the velocity thing in MIDI to play around with it. What I did here actually is I used one of those Cubase tricks. I used the Logic Editor, and you have those logical presets. And what you can do is there are those presets here called random velocity. So random velocity 60 to 100 or 85 to 100 or 90 to 100. You can actually create your own presets, and you just select your MIDI notes, and then you choose a preset, and then you get this kind of movement here. So I did it for different layers. So this layer here, this one hi-hat is doing that kind of movement. This is doing that kind of movement. So that's one thing. And then the other thing is the actual plugin itself is also doing some random stuff. So altogether, it gets very natural sounding. Where I left off is the end of the break part here, and now I want to return to the second build up and the second drop. So right now I'm at this point here. So now I want to get back into the bass line. I want to start building this up, and this is gonna need a lot of different automation stuff and some build-up sounds. I will need snare fills and lots of stuff to, you know, get the energy in there. Okay, so first thing I would look into is how long should the build-up be and when is the drop coming. I think what I want to do is I want to have a build-up of 30 seconds here. That means the actual length goes from here to here. This section here is going to be the build-up, and then here's the second drop coming. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to copy a certain section of my first drop and going to paste it just there, just for now, just to have all the parts in it. And then, of course, I'm going to change it, not going to, you know, play exactly the same thing, but so I have a point to start with. So you can do it really cool with Cubase. You just select a certain area and I go to edit. This is German version, by the way, but yeah, I think you can figure it out. So I'm not sure what this is in English, in the English version. In German it's called Bereich, so I think in English it would be section maybe. And then you can copy time. Basically, what I'm doing here is copy everything in a certain loop area. This is the first thing here. I do that, and then I go to the point where I want the drop to come in. And again, you go into the same menu, and I do paste time. There you go. And then you have all the automation in here as well. So everything is copied exactly the way you want it to be. Right, so I'm back into the middle section of the first drop. Okay, so now we gotta look into the build-up part. First thing I wanna do is I wanna get the filters right for the bass line. So we gotta start with the cutoff of the first one. This is too high. I want it to start really low and just, you know, get back into that groove. So I'm gonna filter it all down like that. Yeah. And then what could be cool for the build-up is to open up the gate of the arpeggiator to make it, like, you know, start like a staccato arpeggiator sound, and then open it up and make it like more like a pad. And then when it drops back in, I want it to be again like go back into that deep sound with those short sounds, more like the short arpeggiator. Okay, so let's do it here. I'm just gonna increase the gate. Let's see what it sounds like. Yeah. Maybe then we could also go into the silent and increase the release. I'm gonna loop a certain part here. Okay, this doesn't sound right because of the filter. Let me check this. Yeah, we can do it on the second part of the silence, the part B thing. So I'm gonna automate this. What I always do in Cubase is to create new automation, I hit the right button, and then I go into the actual plugin, I record it, how I turn it, and then I got the curve right here recorded. So I'm gonna show you. Okay. Turn off the right thing, and now yeah, I got the curve here. I just recorded it really quick just to get the basic thing here, but I gotta adjust it now. So this is sustain and release. It's two curves. So make it really smooth.
kind of like this. Same thing for the release. Maybe for the release, I'm going to use, I'm not going to do it linear, but I'm going to use the parabola. So you can do that kind of movement. Yeah, kind of like this. So it starts increasing slowly and then it goes faster and faster. Yep. Okay, I have to do the same thing to the other layers. So basically I'm just gonna hit right again and then pull up the two new curves. And now what I want to do is I'm just gonna copy the same thing from the other layer. Okay, gotta delete this and this. Did a mistake. Okay. Now, once again, the filters. I gotta start it from the bottom. Then the two molecular layers. Now you make it a bit slower. Okay. And the second one. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take my second sub, the one that's a bit higher, and put it in here as well, because I want to have that those low mids in here too. Yeah, that's going to be nice, because this feels like a 303 kind of sound, and that's the feeling that I'm aiming for here for the build up. So. Okay. Yeah. Okay. A little trick that I'm always doing with those kinds of snare fills, what I'm doing is I'm actually using a delay. I'm using a scent effect, and that delay is set to, oops, it's set to 118. This is just a Cubase delay. It's set to 1/18th and no feedback, zero feedback, but 1/18th. So when I put that on my snare fill, the snare is 1/4, but like a quarter snare. You know, and then what I can even do is I can automate this and put this from 1/8 to 1/16. So then it goes faster. You can do the same thing if you just cut it and duplicate it, but this way it sounds a bit different because I have a filter on this delay. So this filter is like it's cutting off. It's a high cut. So then the second ones that are duplicated sound a bit different. If you just do it in audio and just duplicate the same sample, it sounds more static. So yeah. Yeah, I think we're getting there. So I got to do some kind of automation here. I'm actually going to copy the same snare movement at the end of my first build-up, which is like this. What I did here is I actually pitched it with Cubase pitching. So I took the samples and I pitched them down one by one. I think I went like 2 semitones per sample. Boom, 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 and then the drop hits. So I'm just going to copy that. And this little snare effect here on top, this sounds like it's a clap, actually. Oops. Oh, another small trick I'm going to show you is this little plugin here. It's a mixer delay. I think you usually use it for surround effects, but what you can do is you can put a delay on left or right channel. So in this case, this clap, I want it to be like really, really, really wide. And this is the widest thing you can do is just delay, because you get stereo width when you have a delay between left and right channel. That's how what is actually stereo. And in this case with the plugin, I just put like 12 milliseconds on the left channel. And so you have a delay and that makes it really, really, really wide. That's a pure widening effect. I'm just duplicating a couple of the other snare drums that I have in the first build-up. Let's see what it sounds like. Uh-huh. Nice. I'm working with lots of reverbs. That's one of my main things actually always with automation. And then, you know, put like really big reverbs on those snare drums and it sounds like you're in a stadium. And one more thing that I can really recommend to look into always is your panning, actually. I think that's one thing that people forget about these days a little bit. They used to do it a lot better in the 70s. And if you listen to the old recordings, it was so different. And these days, everything is just centered and or stereo. But if you play around with it, if you have, like in that case, I have the one snare drum that is totally mono, and then this clef that's totally white. And first comes in the mono snare drum, and then comes the really wide claps. So, especially when you listen on headphones, it's so cool because you get that widening effect and boom, boom. Yeah. All right. So let's do that automation on the snare drum. I have to grab the first send. have this one. It's here. Okay. I'm gonna pull it up really slowly so it starts from zero and what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create a second effect channel and I'm going to put a second delay on it, and this one is going to be 1/16th. I could do it in the automation of my first delay, but if I do that, then you will hear the switch from 1/8th to 1/16th. I want to avoid that, so I'm creating a second delay. Again, it's the Cubase mono delay. Set it to 1/16th. The feedback I will have to automate. Again, I'm adding a filter on this one. I'm gonna cut the high frequencies. Feedback, let's put it to 50% for the beginning, and then we're gonna have to pull it up. So 1/16. Okay, I'm gonna start this one a little later. So first we have the 1/18, 1/8, and then it's gonna sound like it's getting faster. No, that's too much. And then pull it down before those fills come in. So it's like not exactly yet. You got to be really precise with those curves and tweak them a lot until it's right. So it's, this is actually the hard work, I think, when you arrange a track, all the automation stuff. And I'm gonna add a low cut on the filter because it gets a bit too much in the low frequencies. So let's try this. Yeah. Okay. That's for this snare, and I'm gonna take my contact snare once again. I'm just gonna copy it. And I'm gonna do the same reverb automation that I showed you in the intro. And what I gotta do is I have to filter out those sounds and melodies from the original, because I still got this one loop going on here. One is, I think it's a vocal snippet. Yeah. Because again, we are coming from here. Okay, so I have to find a nice way to fade and filter out all those layers here. I think I'm gonna do this with a high cut filter. My favorite high cut filter is the Sonaxis. This one, it used to be a golden knob. It turned it into silver. I don't know why. I liked it golden, but now it's silver. I'm gonna put it to 12 dB I think is okay. Just gonna automate it. Gonna grab that curve and do like maybe like this. Once my contact snares come in to play, I want all those sounds to be out. So I will try this. And what else do we have? Yeah. Okay. And then the strings. I think this would be nice again if I do it with a high cut filter. I actually got it here already, so I'm just gonna pull it down. Okay. Next one. By the way, what I did here is I used the Face Mistress thing again from Sound Toys. That is the plugin that turns the simple sample into a kind of an arpeggiator. So if I turn it off, it's just the strings again, and with the Face Mistress, it's something completely different. So yeah. Yeah, another filter. Okay. And the last one. This is the Face Mistress again. Creative filter. One thing I want to do here, you know, I still got this melody playing for one more time when it goes into the build up. So I have to cut it out some way to make it in a cool way. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to pull up the large reverb that I have and automate it. So it's going to be like this. Super smooth, and it fades out and sounds very natural. Yeah. Okay. There's some clicking in it. I think it's the release of one of the synths. Yeah, that one. It's probably too short in the beginning. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You always gotta be careful when the release is on 0.0, the silence especially creates those clicks. So just make sure you got like a little bit of release and then it's fine. Very rough still, you gotta tweak so much of the automation and stuff, but this is the basic stuff is in here. I'm actually thinking about adding another 8 bars to that build-up. Those are the kinds of decisions you actually can only make once you play the track live. It's kind of hard to decide that in the studio when you're just sitting here and you're not, you know, you're not in the party mood. So maybe what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna leave it to 16 bars now. I'm gonna play it out this weekend at a show and then see how it goes. And if I feel like, okay, this build-up could have been 8 bars more, then I'm just gonna change it next week. But for now, I'm gonna leave it like this for on 16 bars. Okay, so I just did a gain automation on the snares here. So let's check. It's the right direction, I think. I will have to tweak a lot in the automation of the release thing on the silence and maybe, you know, play around with some reverbs and other stuff. And I'm gonna add a couple of riser sounds to it. But this is the basis for the build-up. So the rest is just tweaking the little details. So, but it's definitely the right direction. So I think that's cool for now.